Good morning, Tribe Church. Let's stand on our feet together and worship. When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. I'm not a captive to the lies. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. No, I won't be shaken. I won't be shaken. No, 'cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. This power that can break off every chain, this power that can empty out a grave, there's resurrection power that can save. The name above all names, the name above all names. There's power that can break off every chain, there's power that can empty out a grave, resurrection power that can save. The name above all names, the name above all names. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance. Come on, church. Stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand.
Spun creations, his pride and adorations, treasures woven by his love. And his careful hands, they hold us safe within his promise of calling and of destiny. Sing it again. We're heaven-spun creations, his pride and adoration, treasures woven by his love. His careful hands, they hold us safe within his promise of calling and of destiny.
There's a grace when the heart is on fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. When I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire. Standing next to me, there was another in the waters, holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding of how I've been set free, there is a cross that bears the burden where another died for me. There is another in the fire. Dead left for dead beneath the waters. I'm no longer a slave to my sin anymore. between what remains of me and this reckoning. Either way, I won't bow to the things of this world. Still is and will be through it all. So come what may in the space between all the things unseen and this reckoning. I know I will never be alone. Darkness bows to it. I can hear the roar in the heavens as the space between resting. I can feel the ground shake beneath us as the prison walls cave in. Nothing stands between us. Nothing stands between us. Another in the fire standing next to me. Come every battle, cause I know that's where you'll be. I got the joy. Come every battle, cause I know that's where you'll be.
Lift up Jesus this morning. Come on, church.
Good morning, tribe. I am Pastor Carrie Dilley.
I'm Pastor Matt Dilley.
And whether this is your first time at tribe or your first time in a long time, we are so glad that you're worshiping with us this morning.
This is the time every single week we like to just set aside and just invite God's presence into this place. I don't know about you, but I felt him right there in that worship, right there, that God is with us even when sometimes it's difficult, even our difficult seasons of life, even when we have struggles and we have problems. Sometimes when you're in the midst of it, it's hard to see him, but when we look back, we could see there was another in the fire with us. We can look back and know that there was someone helping hold back those waters. And that is such a good truth this morning. Let's pray together. God, we thank you so much for being a God who cares about us so much to have that kind of relationship with us, that you see us in our darkest times, you see us in our darkest pit, you see us in our darkest hour, and God, you are there with us. And sometimes, God, it's so hard to see that light in the darkness, but God, we know when we look back, we can see you just holding things back from us, holding back that darkness, holding back all those past issues. And God, I don't know what issues people came in here with today. God, I don't know the past that they've lived, but I know that God, with you, there is a future. And I know that you are willing to dissipate, get rid of, toss away their past, God, and say, I have paid that debt for you. And now you can live your new life with me as your king and me at the head. And God, we just are so thankful for that. We're thankful for your grace and your forgiveness. We're thankful for your love. And God, we thank you for being in this place today. In your name we pray.
All right. Well, when you came in here this morning, you should have been given a worship guide. Inside that worship guide, you will find a connect card. That is the best way for us to get in touch with you, to start that relationship with you. At Tribe, we don't believe in membership. We believe in relationship, and that has to start somewhere. So I promise, if you fill out your connect card, we're not going to show up at your house or do anything weird, but that helps us to kind of know who's here and who's not, and to kind of keep up with what's going on. The other way to get involved is to attend Tribe Together. If you've attended Tribe Together ever, just give me a little applause right now. That is awesome. All right, so Tribe Together is this little class that we do right after service in this room, in that little corner right over there. We do it every single week, and it's just a way to get to know us, to find out what we're about, find out the core values, get to know me and Pastor Matt over here.
What's up?
He can sing too, girls. Can you believe it? Stay away. Just saying, if you've heard him preach, you've heard him sing, you get it now, right? It's awesome. Anyway, all right, so Tribe Together, attend that after service today. It's amazing. The next thing I have for you is life groups. We are tribe groups. Correct me when I say that wrong. Tribe groups. If you are not in a tribe group, you need to get in a tribe group. Text this number. You're going to get a list of all the different groups that we have going on this semester. We would love for you to get involved with a tribe group. We're going to talk a little bit about that more in the sermon today. And then the other thing, and if you miss the number's the same. The words are different, but the number's the same. Tribe is what you text for life groups. Baptism is what you text if you want to get baptized here next Sunday. We are going to have a baptism service right after church. It's going to be amazing. I am already crying. So it's going to be awesome. So if you are interested in baptism, please text us. We will get with you this week and get all of the theological and the literal readiness for baptism next week. That's all I have for you this morning. Go ahead and greet the people around you. It's called Tribe for a reason. Introverts, this only lasts 30 seconds. Extroverts, you have 30 seconds to hug as many people as possible. Go.
Upon a hill across the blue lake, that's where I have my first heartbreak. I still remember how it all changed. My father said, don't you worry, child. See, heaven's got a plan for you. Don't you worry now.
There's no bumper video for this one. All right, I'm going to do some rearranging here. It's okay. This guy, he's new. Sorry, that was a bad joke. All right. So we are in our last week of our You Asked For It series. Moves table. We are in our last week of our You Asked For It series. And if you're wondering where we got the idea for this series, it came from the Bible. Everybody shocked by that? No. When Jesus would walk around in all the different places that he would walk around, people would ask him questions, and he would answer those questions. And those answers to those questions a lot of times became what we now call scripture. It became the sermons that we quote from, that he preached. So people were always asking Jesus questions. And so what we thought we would do here at Tribe because we want the Bible to guide our teaching as much as possible, is we'll do the same thing. So a few weeks ago, we asked you what you wanted to know. We did this through a couple of different social media posts, and we had a few responses, but we just had a few responses. So the next time that we do this series, because I think this is going to be like a yearly or bi-yearly or something like that, because there's a lot of different questions that we know that people have. The next time, what you need to do is you need to ask questions. Okay, so if you need to take a picture of this to help you remember or whatever, ask questions. There is not a question out there that is too much for God, and there is not a question out there that we're afraid of. Okay, so whatever like things that have kind of always bothered you, we had a couple that were like really specific that we couldn't do a whole sermon series on, but we would love to stack up like some little short answers and do like one whole sermon of just like, hey, here's what this is and here's what this is, and let's talk about the zombies that are found in Ezekiel and all that kind of stuff. Like, we would love to do a whole sermon on that, but we need the questions. So the next time we do this series, I need you to ask questions. Can you do that for me? Awesome, good, okay. All right, I'm going to hold you to that promise, all right? So, I know that you have questions for us, and that's the reason that I know that is because you ask us. You ask us when we're setting up. You ask us when we're tearing down. You text us questions. There's lots of different ways that you ask us questions, and so when I was looking at this sermon series and thinking about what do I want to preach about, what question do I feel like I need to answer for our congregation? Or not I, but God through me. And I decided that the question that I would work with is, how do you handle stress? And I chose that question because I think this is something that is really close to our hearts. And it's an issue that makes us feel really, really trapped. I think a lot of us feel really stressed out, and we don't know what to do about it. We don't know how to sort of stand up under it. According to one article that I read this week, stress levels in our nation are at an epidemic level. And for those of you who remember the Greek and Latin, epi means like disease or whatever, I think that's right. But I know for sure dem means people. D-E-M means people. And so it means it affects everybody. When something is at an epidemic level, it means it affects everybody. So when you're stressed out, that affects you. But it also affects your people. The people that are in your circle are affected by the fact that you're stressed out. And so it means almost everyone is stressed out or affected by stress. And of course we are. There is stress to perform at work. There's stress in marriage. I don't even want to talk about stress in dating. Can we just talk? Did you hear that little laugh? Yeah. Can we just take a minute and like pray for our single people? Because if y'all have been married more than a couple of years, dating has changed. I haven't dated since 2001, and there are apps for it now, guys, apps. You heard the S on the end of that word? That means it's plural. There are multiple apps. When I talk to my single people in my life, like, it takes about 5 minutes where they talk about dating before I'm like a ball under the table, just rocking. Because it's so stressful. If you have kids, you have stress. If your kid is involved in literally anything, that adds another layer of stress. The expectations of the people in your life are stressful. Having any kind of a deadline is stressful. If you're sick, that adds more stress. If you're chronically sick, that adds even more stress. And if you're taking care of someone who is chronically sick. Dill, are you over there? Can you get my drink? I'm like, oh, he's not over there. I'm just going to grab this. It's fine. It's just fine. Here we go. I sang real hard today, you guys. All right. Being stressed can actually make us sick, because when we're stressed out, we don't sleep as well. There are physical symptoms to depression that we're going to talk about. It makes our hearts beat too fast, and they have other signs of duress that are present in our bodies. And then if you think about that too much, like being stressed is going to make me sick, that will also stress you out. There's so much. Unresolved sin can be a stressor in our lives. Any kind of conflict is a stressor in our lives. And then on top of all that, we have to pay our bills and save for retirement and save money and exercise and get 10,000 steps every single day. And then we have to go home and eat dinner every single night. It's just too much. There is just so much that can stress us out in this world. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. This is not from the Bible.
This is from Bossy Pants by Tina Fey. You ready? So she tells the story in her book about stress, and I just love it because I think it paints such an accurate picture of all of that stuff that I just listed with our problems and the things that stress us out. So her family is Greek, and they lived in a family with a bunch of other, or I'm sorry, they lived in a neighborhood with a bunch of other Greek families. And one day, a family from their neighborhood went to a wedding that was like just down the street. And the mom and the dad said, hey, we don't want to take our 4-year-old and our 1-year-old to the reception. If you have children, I'm sure you can imagine the stress that having children at a wedding adds. And so they said, they wanted to drop their kids off at Tina's parents' house because I guess they weren't going to the wedding for some reason. And they were going to go to the reception. Tina's parents were going to watch these two little kids. And so there's two things that you need to know about this. It's the 70s, and so they're dressed all the way up. This little boy's 4, little girl's 1. They're dressed for this wedding still. So he's got on like a tiny little suit, and she's got on like a big floofy dress. There you are. The other thing you need to know is the children had literally never been away from their mother before. The mom was always with these kids. She'd never left them with any kind of a babysitter. So the parents leave, and the little girl starts just losing her mind. You know that loud screaming cry that toddlers can do, like the reason Matt and I don't have more children? That's what she does. And she doesn't stop. Like, this goes on for hours. She's just screaming and crying and screaming and crying. And again, remember, it's the 70s. So Tina Fey's 70s mom puts the baby in, like, a playpen. Because I guess they tried, like, comforting her and bouncing her, and it wasn't helping. So they're like, well, maybe we just need to leave her alone. So they put her in the playpen, and she's still just screaming and crying. So as this has gone on for, like, you know, 45 minutes or an hour or whatever, the little boy starts, like, shedding layers of his tiny suit. So he's walking around. He's just got on, like, the little pants, and his little socks, and his little, like, unbuttoned shirt. And he just starts pacing around this little playpen. And he's, like, pacing, and he's, like, grabbing his little head, and he's, like, getting all, like, stressed out. And all of a sudden, he finally, like, in Greek, he throws back his head, and he says these words, and he says them in Greek. He says, oh, my Maria, what is to become of us? Like... And I think that's us a lot of the times. I think we get ourselves all worked up. I think we're these tiny little people dressed up like grown-ups who truly have nothing to worry about. Like, our parents are just down the street, and they're coming back. They're going to come back, and it's going to be fine. And we're running around in circles, and we're losing our minds. These kids were going to be fine, but they couldn't possibly believe it. I know that you are stressed out. And I know that some of you here today have some really serious things going on in your lives. But I think a lot of the stress that's with us, we're just little people from the 1970s holding onto the playpen rails going, oh, what is to become of me? And our parents are down the street. They're going to come back. It's going to be fine. So that was my Tina Fey story. There you go. Just so you know, that was not from the Bible. The Bible does have a lot to say about stress. And a really great way to know if you're asking the right questions is if the Bible has a lot to say about something, then it's probably a really good question to ask. And the Bible does have a lot to say about stress. In fact, Jesus promises that we would have stress in our lives. In John 16:33, it says, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. Not in me, but in Jesus, you may have peace. In this world, you will have trouble. Notice I made that yellow. Will. In this world, you will have trouble. But take heart, I have overcome the world. I think sometimes we forget that the Bible's promises are not all sunshine and glory, because this verse right here is a promise from God, and it's not my favorite promise, frankly, because it says that we will have trouble. We will. The Bible doesn't say that you're not going to have trouble, or once you make that decision to follow Jesus, that it's going to be easy. One of the things that we say is when we baptize somebody, we are putting a bullseye on their back for Satan, because Satan doesn't like happy people. He doesn't like intact families. He doesn't like people who are productive and are working their way towards Jesus. He doesn't like that, and he's going to do everything he can to throw up roadblocks in that. But take heart, I have overcome the world. God's solution isn't for us to not have trouble. I think you have to know that. God's solution isn't for us to not have trouble. God's solution is that in the middle of your trouble, you can have peace. And that's what I want to show you today. I can't take away your stress. I wish I could. But I can guarantee you that you can find peace in your situation. Another verse that I really like comes from Psalm 34:19. It says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him, I added or her, ladies, out of all of them. I'm sure if it was written now, they would have had or her in there, or a gender neutral pronoun. It's okay. But many are the afflictions of the righteous. Many, many, many are the afflictions of the righteous. People often ask me how I handle all the stress of what I do. A lot of you know that Matt and I are bivocational, meaning that we work full-time for Tribe. We're both considered lead pastors. And then I'm also a full-time teacher. I teach over at Van Buren Elementary, I'm also a wife and a mom of two kids that are not so little anymore. My kids are involved in stuff after school. Bailey takes a little art class, and Jackson plays for the Plainfield Optimist Soccer League. Matt and I are here every Sunday at 6:30 a.m. We're usually the last ones out the door at 12. We go home, we eat, we sleep, and then we host high school and college age people in our house almost every Sunday night. Life is really full right now, but I refuse to use the word busy. That's a different sermon, but I refuse to use the word busy. I don't like that. There was a long time in my life when people would say, hey, how are you? I'm like, oh, we're just really busy right now. What do you say to that? That doesn't help anybody. But our lives are full, and they're full because everything that I just told you, working full-time outside of Tribe, working full-time for Tribe, the stuff that we do with the youths on Sunday, the stuff that we do with the leadership team and the staff here at Tribe, all of that is our choice. We picked all of this. We're doing all of this by choice. And I would be remiss to say if I didn't say that a big part of the reason that I'm able to accomplish what I do is because I have learned to ask for help. The biggest thing, though, that keeps me upright is this verse right here, is that many are the afflictions, but the Lord delivers us out of all of them. Many are the afflictions of a wife and a mother and a teacher or a husband and a person who has some sort of other job. I don't know. I can't think of anything that's not a teacher right now. A leader, a teacher, a daughter, a son, a sister, a brother, a coworker, or even a pastor. But God, the Lord, is going to deliver us out of all of those things. The purpose of praying and reading your Bible and spending time in Bible study, which I think are two different things, being in a Tribe group that are starting here this week, some of them are starting this week, serving at church is giving God the space to create margin in your life for his voice to be heard and his peace to be felt. I'm going to say that one more time. The purpose of all of the stuff that goes along with being a Christian is to give God the space to create margin in your life for his voice to be heard and his peace to be felt. If I'm being honest, guys, this is why I kind of frost my cookies when people are like, oh, we just don't have time to serve in the church right now. Honey, you don't have time to not serve in the church right now. The closer you get to God and to his people, it gives you the capacity to stand up in the middle of what's stressing you out. It does. Let's go back to that word afflictions. You see the word afflictions up there? Many are the afflictions. This is a Roman word that refers to a form of punishment that they used to use. They would stand you up, and they would tie you to this post, and then they would stack rocks on you one by one until it crushed you to death. Do you feel that with the stress in your life? You're like, add this rock, and add this rock, and add this rock, and add this rock. It's a perfect word for this verse. You can feel it. And I know that you're probably saying to yourself, Carrie, how is getting more involved at church? How is adding something else to my plate? How is that going to help take rocks off of me? When you are involved in something that is life-giving, that is fun, that is light, that is playful, it makes everything else seem better. And it also shows you what's really, really important in life. We're going to talk about that a little bit more here in just a minute. And please know that we want you to leave here today with promises and principles that can make a difference for the stress in your life, because we love you. Matt and I love you. Your go team loves you. That's the people who make Tribe, that's the go team, that's the people who make Tribe happen. They love you. The people who sacrifice their time in service so that they can serve in the children's area and watch the sermon, you know, Monday, Tuesday, whatever, they love you. We wouldn't want you to go through life as just a ball of stress because we love you and we want you to feel better. We want you to be better. Okay? Everybody good with that? Yep. Okay. Just making sure you're still with me. It's dark in here and it's hot outside. A bunch of us walked in the parade yesterday. We walked up 40. They kept saying we were going to walk down 40. I'm like, no, it's not down. It's up. I have seen it. All right. So we're going to go to another verse in Psalms. This is Psalm 62, 5 through 8. It says, "Find rest, O my soul, in God alone. My hope," it says my home, but it's, I think it's supposed to say my hope comes from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. We actually sang that today, didn't we, guys? My salvation and honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. Trust him at all times, O people. Pour your hearts out for him, for he is our refuge. And then it says Selah. Do you know what Selah means? It means a break. It means a pause. Because these were songs. These were things that people would sing, these psalms. They would sing these songs. And then sometimes they would say Selah. And so this is kind of the ancient equivalent to like when a worship pastor will say like, just repeat that verse right there. Or when there's like a musical interlude and like those words kind of hang in the air and you can feel them. That's what Selah means. It means a breath. It means a pause. And I'm so glad that you're at church today because our goal is to offer you refuge here. Right here in this place where people watch movies, we want this to be your safe place. We want this to be the place where you don't feel those rocks stacked up on you anymore. We want this to be the place where you are able to redirect your thoughts back to God. And I even want to give you a second here just to sit back and in quiet and in rest in these words and this verse right here. Just breathe in for a minute and soak those words in. Okay, can we talk about the brain for just a second? If this is your first Carrie Dilley sermon, you need to know that I can't talk about God without talking about the intricacies that he designed in our brains. And though, for those of you who haven't heard a Carrie Dilley sermon before, that's what I can't do it. And if you are familiar with that, like, can we take a minute for the fact that I waited this long? Like, I'm doing so good today, you guys. One of the big functions of the brain is to control the nervous system of the body. You guys know the nervous system, right? You're familiar? Everybody got one? Good. That's the nerves that go all over your body. You have muscles and bones and other stuff in there, but the nerves are the ones who are running the show. And your nervous system is, I looked all this up, you guys. Your nervous system is split into two parts. You have the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous systems. The sympathetic nervous system is the one that controls your physical activity. It's the one that gears you up for physical activity. It's your body's fight or flight mode. That's where all of that comes from. When the sympathetic nervous system is activated, it increases your blood pressure. It gets your heart pumping, adrenaline, those sorts of things. The parasympathetic nervous system is the one that controls the things that we don't have to think about digestion, causing the heart to just sort of beat normally, you're breathing when you're sleeping, all of that organ function. And when it is activated, it actually decreases our heart rate and lowers our blood pressure, okay? Listen, this is where it gets really good, you guys. Are you ready? The simple act of breathing that we just did, when we breathe in, that activates the sympathetic nervous system. But when we breathe out, that activates the parasympathetic nervous system. Do you understand what this means? When we breathe in deep and exhale slowly, we are literally causing the body to calm down. When we do this, we find rest and our bodies start to find peace. You know, we talked a lot about like water and a protein snack. This is the step before the water and the protein snack to get that amygdala to stop flipping out. That's the one in the middle that controls the emotions. This is the first step is our very breath. God didn't just tell us to like be still and know that he is God. He built it into our DNA. Think about that for a minute. He didn't just say, find rest, oh my soul, in God alone. He built it into us. He built a system into our bodies to make this happen for us. That gets me every time. We cannot breathe in the future or the past. We can only breathe into the present. And God wants our soul to find rest in the present because he is safe and he is good. Psalm 62 goes on to say, those of low estate are but a breath. Those of high estate are a delusion. And in the balances, they go up. And together, they are lighter than a breath. If we categorize a lot of the things that stress us out, I think that the three big topics we would see are relationships, which we've spent a lot of time on relationships already this year, so I'm not going to touch on this one a lot. If you're looking for help with relationships, go back to the Uncommon series that was like back in the spring sometime. There's a series called Uncommon. You can write that down. Go back, watch that series again. It's really, really good on relationship. But we're going to spend the bulk of our time on the other two, time and money, how we spend our time. You can't do all that you are currently doing. Look at what this verse says again. It says, those of lower state are but a breath, and those of higher state are a delusion. In the balances, they go up. That's kind of wonky. Like, what does that even mean? Do you remember those, like, scales at school? This is the scale symbol, I think. Those scales, and you, like, put, like, paper clips or your eraser or whatever on one side, and those little gram things. You're like, oh, my eraser weighs this many grams, and it was kind of a fun way to spend a Friday afternoon in elementary school. That's what this is talking about. This verse is telling us that when our lives are put on a scale, and along with either the life of a rich person if you're poor or a poor person if you're rich, that's what the low and the high estate here mean, that together those are lighter than a breath. Blow on your hand right now. Like, your life is smaller than the breath in your hand. In the scope of humanity, in the scope of eternity, your life is smaller than that breath in your hand. Technically, that's your life plus the life of another person, either poor or rich, depending upon where you're at financially. That's how small we are. Okay? Is that crazy? That stress anybody out a little bit? I don't know. Sorry, that was a bad joke. All right, so in the book of Daniel, we have this weird story about King Belshazzar, who decides to throw himself a party for, like, him and, like, 1,000 or so of his nearest and dearest. And this is what he does, okay? He was Nebuchadnezzar's son, and when Nebuchadnezzar was in power, he had taken all of this, like, gold and silver and, like, serving and all this stuff. He'd taken all this stuff out of the temple, and he did this, like, big time on purpose. This was, like, a big thing that he did. And so his son decides he's going to throw this party, and he's like, hey, remember all that stuff that my dad took out of the temple? Let's just, like, go get it and use it to have this party. Does that sound like a good idea or a bad idea? Bad idea, right? So they're in the middle of this party, and this hand, this is a true story, guys, this hand comes out of nowhere, like, in the middle of the party, just, like, pops up, and it starts writing on the wall, and it writes this, like, weird thing. It writes, many, many tekel parson. That's what it writes on the wall. And I assume that these people are pretty drunk at this time, and they're freak out, and they're like, what does it mean? And so Daniel, who's been interpreting stuff for this family for generations at this point, comes out, and he says what it means. So many, many means God has numbered the days of your kingdom. And then the tekel means you have been weighed, and the balances have been found wanting. And parson means your kingdom is going to be divided. And I feel like the messages of these two passages are pretty clear and consistent. Like, even though they're not in the same book, they're not talking about the same event, they're pretty clear and they're pretty consistent. And that's that your time is limited. And so we need to spend it well. We need to look at our lives and decide what our purpose is. Pastor Matt preached on purpose a couple of weeks ago as a part of this series. And if you missed it, you should go check it out on our YouTube or our Facebook page for sure, because he's a great pastor and I really like listening to him. Your purpose is a lens that you should use to guide all of your decisions. Every time you're doing something and you feel like this is something that you need to be doing or whatever, you need to be asking yourself, is this moving me and my family towards our purpose? And if the answer is no, you don't do it. Pastor Matt said it like this a couple of weeks ago. We need to regularly be asking ourselves, what am I doing that I should be doing? And or should not be doing? And what am I doing that I should be doing? Both of those questions. What am I doing that I should not be doing? Doing that I shouldn't be doing? What am I doing not doing that I should be doing? That's really hard to say. Wow, you didn't mess that up at all. Like, that's amazing. That was, yeah, that's so good. I thought this was really good, so I just straight up stole it. From his sermon and put it into mine. We need to put boundaries on our time. I read in A Million Little Ways by Emily P. Freeman that when we put first things first, we get second things thrown in. There's space and margin for our lives. When we put the important things first, there's space and margin in our lives to throw in other things. But when we put second things or even third things first in our lives, we get neither. We don't get the second things, and we definitely don't get the first things. Think about that old rock metaphor. Remember, like, we had, like, a jar, and you'd put, like, the big rocks in, and then, like, the medium-sized rocks, and the pebbles, and then the sand, and then the water. Do you remember that, like, old metaphor? Are we tracking with that? Okay. You have to put the big rocks in and then the smaller rocks. The order is not going to work any other way. You can't put the water in first and then put something. It just doesn't, nothing else works except to put it in that order, biggest to smallest. And I think part of our problem in the United States today is that we have not only shifted the order of the rocks, but we have shifted the size of the rocks. And I think that we think that there are some pebbles that we're treating like big rocks. There are some things that should be like second, third, fourth, fifth on the list that we're treating like it's the most important thing that we do. And one of the things that Matt and I have done over the last year is we try really hard, notice I said try really hard, not to work from Friday night to late Saturday afternoon, which is really, really difficult. It's hard to take a Sabbath because ministry is 24/7. And I think sometimes we get the idea of like, well, if we're doing good things in the name of the Lord, it doesn't matter if we're working like 18 days straight in a row, right? Wrong. No, that is not how it works. Sabbath is a critical part of being a Christian. So it's so critical that both God and Jesus modeled it for us. Think about that for a minute. There's not a whole lot that they both modeled for us. Jesus had so much more time, you know, with us. He's God with us. So he had so many more things that he did, but that one of the things that he made sure that he did was he took time for Sabbath. And I promise, if you make time in your week for Sabbath, God is going to lighten your load, and he's going to give you peace. And I don't think that our God is a God of legalistics. He doesn't care if you Sabbath from Friday night to Saturday afternoon, or if you Sabbath like all day Sunday, or if it's 3 hours a night every single night. What he cares about is you taking time for you on purpose. And you're going to have to do this for yourself, because no one else is going to be like, oh, you need to take a step back. Everybody else is going to be like, here, put some more stuff on your plate. But you have to do this in order to rest and reconnect with him. It's very important. Psalm 62 goes on to say, I know we're saying Psalm 62 a lot today, put no trust in exhortations, set no hopes on robbery. If riches increase, do not set your heart on them. We need to be regularly checking in on how we're spending our money. Does this align with our family's purpose? Remember, I said that purpose is a lens that we're going to look through. We're going to see everything through that lens. We don't have to balance our checkbooks anymore. God bless us, everyone. Like, we have apps that handle that for us. But we do have the responsibility to make sure that our money is being spent wisely. If you're looking for a place to start, seriously, start checking on your spending. That's the first thing. That's the very first thing you should do. Make sure there's not some subscription to some dumb app that you've forgotten about that's sucking away part of your income every month. Make sure that you have one of those apps that tracks, maybe get one of those apps that tracks your spending so you can see, like, the little pie graph and be like, oh, man, Starbucks was a little high this month. Like, maybe we should, like, you know, check that. Maybe we should step back on that a little bit. And I'm preaching to myself here, guys, because the Violent drink, it's so good. And nobody else makes it, and I've tried to make it at home. I really have. I try to be frugal. It's just not the same. I've tried. I really have. We need to take care of our money. And we need to know where it's going. And make sure that it isn't going into the wrong places. And I don't know what those places are for you because it's different for everybody. We also need to guard our hearts against the love of money. 1 Timothy 6, 6-10 say, but godliness with contentment is great gain. For we are brought, we brought nothing into the world and we can take nothing out of the world. I think about this with Tribe all of the time because we literally came out of nothing. Like, we talked about it last week at our one-year anniversary, that at one point, Tribe was just Matt and I standing in our bedroom crying. we literally came from nothing. And we have seen God bless this church time and time again. 1 Timothy goes on to say, but if we have food and clothing, with these we will be content. Food and clothing. That's it. That's all it says we need to be content. I think the other stuff that we spend our money on sometimes just compounds our stress. One of my really good friends a couple of years ago moved out of a really big house into a much smaller house. And I think what a great model for lowering your stress, because less rooms to clean, less rooms to heat, less rooms to cool, less stuff to take care of, because our stuff sometimes becomes just another layer of stress in our lives. Yeah, we get these things, we have to take care of them. All right, so keep going with Timothy. But if we have food and clothing, but those who desire to be rich fall into temptation and into snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. Do you know what one of the number one, you see that word destruction? You know what the number one things people fight about in marriage is? Money. Yeah, you know it. And I think about that sometimes. Is money worth your family? Like, think about that. The people. Think back to like the very beginnings of those relationships. Are these people that are in your life, are they worth like getting stressed out about money and fighting about it? All right, the last part of this verse says, for the love of money is the root of all kinds of evils. Not money itself, but the love of money. Money isn't bad at all. Money is the way that we paid for the candy that we passed out at the parade yesterday. And all of those invite cards. Those cost money that we passed out. We had 3 people on our website during the parade yesterday. That's pretty cool, right? Yeah. That's really cool. We passed out a lot of candy yesterday. And that was actually, most of that was donated by one person, which is just the coolest thing. But do you know what else Tribe has done over the last year? We've launched 24 churches in the last 2 weeks. So we had 20 new churches launch last week and 4 churches launch this week. This is ARC. This is one of our sending organizations. And we have tithed back to ARC every Sunday that we've been a church. So the principle of tithing that we preach, that we say 10% of your income goes, you know, in theory, if you want to be super legalistic about it, 10% of your income should go back into like something godly. Okay, doesn't have to be here. You could sponsor, 100 kids overseas if you want to. If you want to sponsor another church or you want to send your money to another church, that's fine. But 10% of your income is supposed to go back to God. And at Tribe, we practice that even with the money that is tithed to us. We tithe back to this organization and then 2 others. But in the last 2 weeks, we have launched 24 different churches. That's amazing. And the reason we do this is not because we don't think there's enough churches in the United States, but we believe in church planting. We invest in church planting because we believe in church planting. Did you know that after a church is 10 years old, the chances of reaching the unchurched and the dechurched decrease significantly? Most of the growth after 10 years comes either from transfer from other churches or from birth. And I don't know about you guys, but I'm not having any more babies. At Tribe, we believe in church planting. And there's a difference between a tithe and an offering. So a tithe is that 10%. An offering is like above and beyond. And so one of the things that we did is 2 of the churches that launched last week launched a little low. And I don't know if you know this or not, but we launched a little lower than we were projected to. And while we were so excited about the 167 people that were here on our very first Sunday, there's still like a little bit of sour in there that we were like, oh, would have been really cool to be over 200. or at 250 where we were projected to launch. And so we sent, from Tribe, we sent gifts to two people. Just little things that said, like, hey, we see you. We're rooting for you. We're still here. It's been a year. But the love of money is dangerous. That's because so money can do all of those really good things, but the love of money is dangerous. It says, it is through this craving that some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pangs. If we replace the word pangs with stress, I think you can see it. And if any of this money stuff is stressing you out right now, hearing me talk about this, I highly recommend you check out our life group. You can text this number for life group right now. We have a life group called Financial Peace University. It's led by the magnificent Travis Checkets. Did I say it right, Trav? T Smooth. Yeah, he was one of our 5 for 5 last week. And so if this stresses you out, check out that. If the money thing stresses you out, if you're like, my finances are a mess. And guys, I stood in line with a bunch of people when I started my new job a couple weeks ago. Nobody knows anything about their finances. If teachers are any indication, like, we were all like, how much are you going to invest? I don't know. What are we supposed to do? Which service do we pick? I don't know. This is super stressful. Go to Financial Peace. Find out what it's all about. I think they have it's a really, really great class. All right, one more verse. Jeremiah 6:16 says, stand by the roads and look and ask for the ancient paths where the good way is. Walk in it and find rest for your souls. That's what we need to be doing. Are you tired? Are you stressed out? Do you feel overwhelmed like all of the time? That is no way to live. That is not how God wants you to live. God wants you to find your purpose and use that as a lens for how you spend your time and your money. Close your eyes with me for just a second. And even if it's uncomfortable, I want you to hold out your hands, palms up, just right in front of you. And I'm going to pray for us. God, we came here with nothing. God, we know that our lives are just but a little tiny wisp. They're just a breath. Jesus, we pray that you would give us the courage it takes to start setting boundaries in our lives with our time and with our money. God, give us peace. Help us to seek you first and know that it is only then that we can, that all this other stuff is going to be added to us. God, help us to add up all of our stuff back into our lives up in the right order. Jesus, we want to put it in there in the right order. Help us to choose those right paths that it talks about in Jeremiah. Help us to choose to walk with you because we know that this is the only path that leads to peace. And if you are exhausted from trying to live life on your own, do not let another day go by without praying this prayer. God, I am tired of trying to do it on my own. I am ready to put down my stress at your feet. I'm ready to make you the Lord of my life. And I am sorry for the times when I've screwed it up. I'm sorry for the times when I've tried to fix it on my own. I see that I can't do it on my own. If you're praying this with me right now, just raise your hand. I see you in the back. I see you. Jesus, come into my life. Fill my heart and my soul with your love. Help me to pour out that love on the people around me. Father, reduce my stress. Help me to see clearly what is truly important and choose the right path. I know that this prayer is just the first step. Help me make that second step obvious to me. Keep me close, Father. Forgive me of my sins. Help me to be better. God, I want to be better. Jesus, I came here with nothing. But I am leaving here today with the gift of eternal life. Amen. All right. At Tribe, we like to celebrate life change. We like to celebrate when people make life-changing decisions. Yes. Thank you. And also at Tribe, we offer every week the opportunity to give back part of what has been given to us. We don't want you to feel any obligation to give, especially if this is your first time.
But you are going to see other people dropping their Connect cards, dropping offering envelopes into our giving station, which is out here in the hall, because they do call Tribe Church home, and they do believe in what we're doing here in Plainfield and throughout the world through our sending organizations. So I'm just going to pray for our offering really, really quick.
Real quick, I want to mention that we have Tribe Together that's right over there, right after service. We would love to meet you and get to know you. It's a
Absolutely.
Great way to find out what's going on at Tribe and exactly, you know, how we came to be and where we're going. And then also, next week, we start a brand new series, and it's called The Bible for Grownups. I think a lot of us, when we grew up, you were handed, like, this Bible and as a child, and you were told, you know, you need to believe everything in this and do your best to abide by it, right? And then when you get older, you find out that's kind of difficult, and it's harder than you thought. And a lot of it has to do with the fact that we've heard a lot of stories from the Bible, but we haven't heard the story of the Bible. Yeah. So we're going to dive into that and find out a little bit more about what it means, like how the Bible came to exist, and why we could put our faith in it.
I'm going to pray first. God, we came here with nothing. God, I am constantly blown away by the generosity of the people here at Tribe. They give us their most precious resources week after week. They give their time, they give their talent, and they give their money. God, we love our people, and we ask that you would bless them this week with the peace and rest each and every time that they give back to your kingdom. Please bless every tithe and every offering. Multiply it tenfold in the life of this church and in the life of our people. We love you, God. Amen.
Thanks, everybody, for coming today. Please remember as you leave this place that love is the best thing we do. Have a good week, everybody.